these contestants were already dead. Each was on death row. After 30 hours, I will set the last one left alive free.
Let's go, sweetheart.
Ruthless killers fight to the death, and it's all on the internet in The Condemned. I'm Richard Roeper, filling in for Roger this week as the film critic from the Associated Press, Christy Lemire. Christy, welcome back.
Thank you so much. Good to be back.
All right, let's get right to it. Our first movie is The Condemned. It presents itself as an action film with a social conscience. But if you give us about 113 minutes of brutal killings, topped off with a two-minute lecture about violence in the media, isn't that kind of blowing up your cake and having it too? Wrestling icon Steve Austin is obviously up with the physical stuff, and he's actually not bad delivering his tough guy lines. He plays Jack, one of 10 death row convicts from around the world. They've all been brought to a remote island for a very deadly version of Survivor.
Open your mouth! Damn it! Damn it! We never saw that coming!
With 400 cameras providing a live feed to the internet, Jack must outwit, outlast, outplay, and outlive the nastiest bunch of killers this side of Con Air. Last killer alive will win freedom.
I got you down as military. Like myself, Special Forces, SIS. Me and you, we got a lot in common.
We got nothing in common, you and me.
That disappoints me! That makes you soft! Not me. I'm the real deal.
Vinnie Jones plays the British psychopath who squares off with Jack. The Condemned isn't the first film about a reality show where the contestants literally kill one another, but it's probably the most violent and the least responsible. Sure, some members of the TV crew express misgivings about this snuff reality show, and we do get that big lecture at the end, but this movie is all about showing us one brutal murder after another, and then showing us the shocked looks on the faces of the home audience. Now, I like violent movies. Movies such as The Devil's Rejects and Grindhouse are probably even more violent than this, but the bloodshed is presented in a stylized manner without the BS social commentary. This is a fast-paced, well-made piece of garbage. That's a thumbs down, Christy.
I love the audacity. Yeah, thumbs down for me, too. The audacity that they're going to indict gratuitous, graphic, senseless violence, but it's from WWE films.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
This is what they peddle. This is what they're known for.
Yeah.
And then to make fun of, like, the media and entertainment for pushing the level of what is considered shocking. It's hilarious. Like, this movie is a comedy. I was laughing at how ridiculous
it is.
Well,
you know, I can laugh at violence when it's done in a cartoonish manner, or again, like I said, if it's done in a stylized way, but here it's so realistic, and they make a big deal out of saying, you know, these are real actors and real stuntmen, and we're not doing CGI. So then I kind of find it to be unseemly, and then to get lectured at the end about, well, we're just giving you what you want, and violence in the media and all this crap. You know, movies like Battle Royale, or even The Running Man, you know, they had the same premise, but they did have something to say about it. This is just like, you're seeing these vicious, brutal acts over and over again, and then we're being told, oh, but that's just what you want. It's not what I want.
Especially toward women, there's a rape.
Nasty
a couple
stuff.
Of really, really horrific beatings
really
against women,
stuff.
And maybe they're wrestlers too, maybe we're all supposed to believe that it's fake, but it's still really hard to watch and really needless, I think. So
yeah.
I had a hard time watching this, and it's over the top and loud and very headache-inducing. I mean, all WWE films are. You've got The Marine with John Cena. You've got See No Evil with the 7-foot dude Kane. And I guess there is an audience for this.
I'd like
who
to see, you know, I'd like to see
it,
all those guys and Steve Austin in a remake of Diner. I think that would be great. They just have to get a big booth so they could all fit in, so they can have their conversation.
It's okay to cry, though. You know, there's a sensitive side of these guys too.
Yeah.
I'm sure, but yeah.
I wept when I got about to the 8th killing in this movie, and I thought, God, it's not over yet.
And it's just so long; it's ridiculous. So yeah, thumbs down. But our next movie is Snowcake, which actually feels more like slush because it is so unpleasant to slog through. Sigourney Weaver plays a woman with autism whose daughter is killed in a car accident at the film's start. Alan Rickman plays the lonely man who was driving the car the girl was riding in. He agreed to give her a lift back to her small Canadian town, even though he's studiously antisocial. After the crash, he feels compelled to seek out the girl's mother, but because of her condition, he doesn't quite get the emotional reaction he'd expected.
I just wanted to explain that I gave your daughter a lift. It was an accident. I'm so sorry.
Okay.
Nevertheless, the two form a friendship, which feels totally false and contrived, but then again, so does everything in Snowcake. Weaver's performance is surprisingly self-conscious and mannered and often just downright cringeworthy.
Linda?
It comes off like a cheesy I Am Sam impression.
You all right?
I'm fine. If you get your mouth completely full of snow, it all dissolves and you can drink it.
At the same time, the script calls for her to say just the right poignant, insightful thing at just the right time, which is helpful because, wouldn't you know it, Rickman's character has a past he needs to work through.
Do people like you, Alex?
Not much, no.
I'm not surprised. It's because those glasses don't look right on your face. You have a long face, and those glasses make you look shifty.
Really?
Yes. You need some new frames.
I think it'll take more than that.
Carrie Ann Moss co-stars as the sexually free-spirited neighbor who Weaver thinks is a prostitute, but Rickman thinks is just swell. The two fall for each other even though they have no chemistry and nothing in common. So yeah, thumbs down from me.
See, you didn't like this, huh?
No,
I can kind of tell you.
No.
Heartless film critic,
I am. I'm cold-hearted.
You know, I'm going to give this movie thumbs up, even though I agree with some of what you're saying. I thought Sigourney Weaver's performance was a little bit affected and, yeah, sometimes cringe-inducing, but that is the case sometimes with people who have autism, and it's sometimes uncomfortable to be around them. And I thought sometimes they struck just the right note without getting too sentimental, for example, in a funeral scene. And I'm mainly recommending this, Christy, for Alan Rickman, who I've loved since the first Die Hard, and he doesn't usually get a chance to be the lead in a movie. And I just thought he had such a beautiful performance here and very nuanced, and I really liked his character and found him interesting. So even though I agree that there's some mannered stuff going on here and maybe things that are a little too convenient, I did like the performance of Alan Rickman so much. I like this film.
No, he's good in everything, and he has great gravitas and great presence. That voice alone is fantastic, but he's given things to do and say that felt totally unbelievable to me, which I think negates whatever talent he might bring to the table.
Well, there are some scenes like that, but I think the relationship with Carrie Ann Moss's character was believable, and I did think they have something in common because they're smart and they're interesting and they're lonely and they stumble into each other's lives for a short period of time. And in fact, I would have liked to see more of that actually than some of the interacting with Sigourney Weaver's character. I know what you're saying. It kind of feels like an overwritten short story brought to film, and it has a Sundance-y in a bad way kind of feel to it. But I still say the performances are terrific overall, and the writing's pretty good, so just enough to recommend it. And
the best character in the whole thing dies in the first 5 minutes.
Oh, no, I kind of thought that was good that
they
knocked her off.
You want to see her
crazy,
get hit by a truck? Nice. You're the cold-hearted film critic now.
Well, okay, I'll take that as a compliment. All right, later in the show, Keri Russell has a pie for every mood in Waitress.
Self-pity and loser pie.
And coming up next, Justin Timberlake in a film I really liked. It got lost in the box office shuffle, so you're going to rent it.
I can't take him to my place. I told you my dad's there.
This week's Thumbs Up videos are brought to you by Raisinettes. Make a deliciously smart choice with Raisinettes.
My brother went through.
What you talking about? What you mean we through?
Come on, Jimmy, your time has passed.
Hey, man, I got soul. You can't kill a man with soul.
Come on, man, let's at least end as friends, man. If you ever need some help, just give me a call.
Looking at the big movies new on DVD this week, Dreamgirls got a thumbs up. And Christy, I still say that Eddie Murphy should have won Best Supporting Actor for the role he played here. I loved Alan Arkin in Little Miss Sunshine, but he was out of the movie halfway through. And Murphy had this huge character arc, and he got to sing and be nasty and be funny. And I thought he was great in this film.
He has a couple of good scenes, I think, toward the end. But Dreamgirls as a whole, I think, was kind of overblown. Mm-hmm. Beautiful, technically flawless, dazzling, really great editing, great choreography, a lot of fun. But really, overrated, I thought.
Well, I did give it a thumbs up, but it wasn't a movie that I put on my top 10 list last year. I liked it. I think for fans of the film, they'll love this DVD because it's got tons of extras, all kinds of things. You know, it's like one of those two-disc specials. So I do give them credit for this, at least coming out right out of the box with a two-disc, fully enhanced version, not doing, here's Dreamgirls, here's the special edition. Yes. I think you're going to get your money's worth if you are a fan of this film. Okay, my video pick as well this week is Alpha Dog, which has a lot of great young actors in it. I thought Justin Timberlake was good, Emil Hirsch. It's directed by Nick Cassavetes, and it's one of those things based on the true story of these kind of bratty California kids who get in way over their heads.
Kid's older brother owes true love money, and Johnny's holding him like a marker or something until he gets paid.
I don't know, for some reason, people just didn't connect with this film. I thought it did a good job, unlike The Condemned, of showing us all this depravity, but then having a real cautionary element to it.
These kids felt real to me, and the acting is intended to be real, and it is. Mm. Justin Timberlake can act.
That's the thing,
you know.
He can
do anything.
I think a lot of people just resent him because he's got so much going on, you know, so many things going in his life, and I'm like, this kid, you know, in movies like this, he's really trying to become a character. He's not just strutting around saying, I'm bringing sexy back, which I really don't need to see in a movie. So he's really good in this. It's a good film.
There's more to him, I think, than we all expected. So.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
My video pick is Little Children, a beautifully written look at supposedly genteel suburbia. The film earned three Academy Award nominations for its screenplay and for its strong work from Kate Winslet and Jackie Earl Haley, making an astonishing comeback 30 years after The Bad News Bears.
I was only trying to cool off!
All right, let's go.
Similar to American Beauty and director Todd Field's first feature, In the Bedroom, Little Children is darkly funny and brutally honest.
Yeah, I loved it as well. So, Dreamgirls, Little Children, and Alpha Dog all will be in stores this Tuesday. Coming up next, we'll tell you why we're not reviewing next. That'll be next. But first, a look at what's coming up on next week's show.
Poker Face.
I got the gun. I shot her in the head. I know it was wrong.
Looking at movies now in theaters, Fracture got a split vote. Kind of ironic since it's called Fracture. In the Land of Women got two thumbs up and another split vote on Vacancy. Okay, now would be the time when I'd start my review of the movie next, starring Nicolas Cage.
I've seen every possible ending. None of them are good for you.
But as has been the case with Cage's last two films, Ghost Rider and The Wicker Man, the movie was not screened for the show, so I can't tell you what I thought of it.
Well, our guy in L.A., Dave Germain, was able to see it this week, but they showed it on, like, Wednesday. Not a great sign. They have a whole lot of faith in the movie.
So they showed it to the Associated Press.
Yep.
I guess they're just anti-balcony.
Right. We're very important.
Well, I can tell you, I did get a chance to catch up with The Wicker Man and Ghost Rider, and in both cases, I probably should have sent flowers to the studio. Right. I'm not saying next is going to be bad. I'm just saying that, you know,
it speaks for itself.
And it is kind of amazing, though, Christy, because we're talking about Nicolas Cage, a major star. I mean, it's one thing if they don't show you, you know, Jamie Kennedy's next film or something like that, but in this case, you're thinking, well, geez, you know, it's Nicolas Cage in three films in a row. We're not screened wide for critics.
Whenever he has hair, it's a bad sign, I think. Those are never good. But there was like a decade there where he made a lot of really hideous choices. 8mm, Bringing Out the Dead, like just really dour roles over and over again, and then adaptation came along. So maybe there's another second or third round of good stuff coming from him.
I hope so, because he's a terrific actor. Okay, since her star turn on the TV show Felicity, Keri Russell has been getting about seventh billing in films such as Mission Impossible 3 and The Upside of Anger. With Waitress, she reminds us of her star power. It opens next week, and this is an early review. In this quirky rural set piece, Russell is sexy and funny and melancholy and just glowing with charm and likability. She plays Jenna, a good-hearted waitress who makes the best pies for miles around and usually keeps up a cheerful front, even though she's married to a pig.
Hey, here's the thing, wife. What if you decide to love the baby more than you love me? Women do it all the time. They have a baby and then it's to hell with the man.
You're jealous of the baby?
No, I don't get jealous. It's below me.
That's the very dependable Jeremy Sisto and a good performance as Earl, who's alternately abusive and infantile around his wife. Nathan Fillion plays Jenna's doctor, who's having a hard time maintaining a professional distance even as he treats the pregnant Jenna.
I think you're strange. I'm not sure I want you to be my doctor anymore. You make me uncomfortable.
I'm sorry, Jenna.
I'm really sorry. Whatever it is I do, I will not do it anymore. You should not be uncomfortable at this time.
You're doing it again.
How? What did I do?
I don't know. You know, that nice guy talky thing you do. I'll forget it.
The legendary Andy Griffith has a lot of fun playing the rich old coot who owns everything in town, including the diner. Of course, there's a heart of gold beneath all that bluster.
You a child.
Shh, quiet.
I seen that look on a woman's face before. Name was Annette. I made sweet love to her all through the summer of 1948. She got that sick look on her face like you had all through the fall.
From time to time, the eccentricities and the sentimental turns are a bit over the top, but the script is more insightful than condescending, and I grew to like all the performances, including the work of Cheryl Hines from Curb Your Enthusiasm. Jenna's narration about the various pies that fit her moods are hilarious. Her feelings of suffocation when dealing with Earl are just heartbreaking. Her love affair with the doc, of course, is ill-advised, but completely understandable. The saddest thing about Waitress is that the co-star, writer, and director of the film, Adrian Shelley, was murdered a few months before the film premiered at Sundance. A longtime indie favorite as an actress, Shelley was really growing as a filmmaker. This is a very good movie with a terrific performance from Kerry Russell. Thumbs up.
Thumbs up from me, too. It's sweet. It's funny. Yeah, it's a bit too folksy here and there. Mm. But I think, yeah, it has its heart in the right place. I love the interplay with Kerry Russell and Nathan Fillion. It's like something out of some 40s screwball comedy. Yeah. Yeah. It's so just wacky and funny, and but they're really adorable together. Her husband's a bit too much of a pig for my liking. I mean, you mentioned he's a pig.
Yeah.
I think he's a little too two-dimensional in that, how could anyone behave this way all the time? And how could somebody as lovely as her stay with him?
You know, I agree, Christy, except for in real life, we see that so often where we're thinking, what is she doing with him? Or what is he doing with her? Where everybody who's looking at this relationship thinks, what is that one person thinking? And I do think that Sisto's character, there are guys like that who, you know, they just get so wrapped up in their wives and they're so dependent on them and then abusive of them, and they just have this strange way, and the woman just can't, in this case, she just can't see a way out. And of course she runs to this doctor and a lot of other things happen. I just, you know, I love the writing here, and Andy Griffith, it's just great to see him on screen.
Oh, he's, the things the they have him saying, so un-Andy Griffith-like.
Yeah,
so
which I love,
it's funny and sweet, so a good choice. Coming up next, Paul Rudd stars in what I think is the best movie on this week's show, Diggers.
My dad just died.
I know that, but I've never seen him happy.
Be sure to check out our new website for full-length video replays of each week's reviews 24 hours a day. Visit atthemovies.tv.com, the online home of Ebert and Roeper.
Our next movie is Diggers, a small charmer in the same vein as The Big Chill, Diner, and Breaking Away. It's about a group of longtime friends in the Hamptons in the 1970s, long before the invasion of Christy Brinkley and Puffy and the like. They're all clam diggers, just like their fathers, and they're trying to hang on to their way of life, even as corporate forces bombard their sliver of Long Island.
In front of the kids, you tell me to break the law.
What are you talking about? I'm just suggesting that maybe you drift near the restricted area. You drop anchor, you pull up a couple of rakefuls, conservation comes by, you just play dumb.
Right, because it's not illegal to be dumb, right? Prisons are filled with geniuses. Albert Einstein Penitentiary.
That's Ken Marino, who co-stars and also wrote the script. He was a member of the MTV sketch comedy show The State, and for those of you who know your Dawson's Creek, he played Katie Holmes's flirty college professor. Mm-hmm. He created characters here who feel incredibly real in the way they support and affectionately needle each other, as well as in their struggles and failures.
Both of my parents are dead, and my ex-husband should be. You know, so this is my time, you know? I just want to enjoy myself, have fun. That's all.
Why does everyone want to have fun all the time? Hey, Dad would flip if he knew that you and Jack...
Yeah, well, Dad's not here anymore. And you're not Dad.
One of the guys, played by Paul Rudd, shows up late to work one morning, as usual, and finds his father slumped over the side of the boat, dead. Eventually, he must go through all the guilt and remorse of not having been there, but his father's death also serves as a catalyst. He actually ponders leaving town and becoming a photographer, which sounds even better once he begins dating a sophisticated Manhattanite, played by Lauren Ambrose.
I'm coming over because we've been looking at each other, and I thought maybe...
Looking, not talking. You ruined it.
Ruined what?
Our silent flirtation.
I didn't ruin anything.
Oh, see, now we're having our first fight.
If there's anything wrong with Diggers, it's that it's not long enough. It can feel a bit superficial. These are characters you want to spend more time with. Think of it as a chick flick for men. It's in theaters on a limited basis right now, and it'll be available on DVD on May 1st. Thumbs up from me.
Big thumbs up for me, Christy. Yeah. I couldn't agree more. I thought the acting here is just so realistic. You know, Paul Rudd is one of these guys. He could be in The 40-Year-Old Virgin or on a TV show and do broad comedy. And then something like this, he's so natural on screen that, you know, I don't think he's appreciated as much as he should be as an actor. Everybody's really good. Just a little slice of life there, giving us an insight into this culture at that period of time. And I'm with you. I wanted another half hour. There's so many movies where I'm sitting there going, oh, man, they could have cut 15, 20 minutes from this story. There's too much going on here. We don't need all this stuff. And here I'm thinking, give us more. I want to get to know these characters more, because, you know, Maura Tierney's character, the guy that's married to the, and they got a million kids. I mean, that was perfectly done, I thought. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I can't recommend this movie enough. I hope people check it out, whether they see it in the theaters or as soon as it comes out on DVD.
It scratches the surface, right, but you want to see more from them, definitely.
Yeah. Terrific film. Okay, we'll be back to recap this week's show right after this.
Closed captioning for Ebert and Roper is sponsored by MovieTickets.com. Don't miss another show. Buy your tickets online at MovieTickets.com, your own personal box office.
Okay, recapping the movies on this week's show. Two thumbs down for The Condemned. We split on Snow Cake. Two thumbs up for Waitress. It opens next week. and two thumbs up for Diggers. And Christy, thanks again for joining me here in the balcony.
Thank you so much. It's always a pleasure. Thank you.
A lot of fun talking about movies with you. Okay, for the full text of Roger's update on his recovery, go to atthemovies.tv.com. That's it for this week's show. Until next week, the balcony is closed.
French toast treasures at IHOP. Delectable cherry vanilla, banana with caramel sauce, or scrumptious strawberry. Come hungry, leave happy.
Experience the most acclaimed motion picture of the year. Winner 2006 Academy Award Best Actress, Helen Mirren. The Queen. Own it today on DVD and Blu-ray disc.
So I figured, listen, I wear the shoes, I like them, I'll buy their stock. That's how I invest.
Oh, that's why I publicly trade.
It's on the New York Stock Exchange, genius.
So you're going to retire off of shoot investments in footwear. That's brilliant.
Oh, boy. Smelly shoes. No smell?
Odor Eaters destroys odor, absorbs wetness. Odor Eaters insoles, powder, and spray.